Let me introduce you to Varun. I have known him for over 10 years, and he's a photography enthusiast, and he has kindly agreed to work with us today and run us through e-commerce photography and how to do that at home. So of course all of us are stuck at home, and it's very difficult to hire professionals to do our photography at this point in time.
So we'll start off. So e-commerce nowadays is the buzzword, especially when we are locked down at home. We currently have essentials coming through to our home through e-commerce as well, so that we do not need to go out. But over the last few years, 4 to 5 years, we've seen this the e-commerce industry really flourishing. And a very, very important aspect of it is photography, because that's all that you have to show to the world as a seller, because nobody is coming through to you to see the products, etc. So the photograph is all that speaks. So that's why I think e-commerce photography is extremely important. What I'll try to cover in this session, I have just listed that down. What is the importance? What are the common mistakes that normally we beginners make? What are the 5-step process that we actually need to follow to be ready with a final photograph to upload? I'll just go through a few settings in the pro mode of your camera, of your phone camera. Everybody has a pro mode in their camera, so I'll just take you through that. We'll try to do a small demo also, where I will show live. I'll try to click a photograph and show you how the output comes through. And we will also touch upon when actually you need a professional, and when you cannot, I mean, you ideally should not go ahead on your own in your e-commerce photography. So we will touch upon those areas or those times when you actually need a professional. So we'll start off with the importance of photography. As I said, the picture is all you have. The more professional a photograph, the more trust it comes out, it demands. So for example, I'll show you a photograph here. It's the photograph of the same product. Now on the left, you can see that it is not a very professional looking photograph, but on the right, it is a very professional looking photograph. There are a lot of post-processing also which has gone behind making the professional photo. But there is more trust you associate with the one which is on the right. So that's the reason why photography is crucial. Okay, so few mistakes, common mistakes which we all tend to make as beginners. We need to understand exposure. Okay, so in technical terms, a photo is underexposed when it is extremely dark. So on the left, you will be able to see where I pointed out as dark. It is underexposed, so you cannot see any details here. While on the right, you will see that it is overexposed. Here, all details are actually burnt out, so you will not be able to see the sky. Even the ground is really, really not looking so good. But in the center image, where it is written as correct exposure, you will be able to see proper details of the sky, proper details of the ground as well. So we have to be very careful when we are exposing our photograph. I will talk about exposure a little later, but this is what a very, very common mistake is, where we either underexpose or overexpose. Framing. Now, this is extremely crucial. A product is in front of you. How do you frame? What all things you need to keep in mind? There are distractions over here. You can see if the product is in the center and there are books or bags lying around here and there, that is a very, very big distraction. You should always try to avoid that. In product photography, you should try to avoid these seams. So when two surfaces are meeting each other, there is a line which we call as a seam, which is created. You should try to avoid that. I will take you through how we avoid it as well. Product or background. Sometimes it's not clean. There is dust on the product. There is dust on the background. The background, what you have, maybe a cloth or whatever, is dirty. So those are distractions. Use microfiber cloth. This is a cloth which will clean the surface of the product without scratching it. So invest in this microfiber cloth. clean up the products and the background before you use them. Image quality. Now, this is critical. If you look at and the image which is titled as pixelated, you can see that you cannot see anything, any details of the photo. It is there are only pixels which are visible. And on the right, it is a grainy photograph. So, there are a lot of dots in the image which will really distract you from the actual subject. So, both these things you need to avoid. We will talk about this in detail as well. Okay, so we'll go on to the steps which we had spoken about. First, sample images. This is a very crucial step. Before you start off with any photography, it is recommended that you go onto sites like Pinterest or sites which you want to upload onto to understand sample images which are already clicked by photographers or professionals. So for example, if you can see this photograph, I have just taken a screenshot from Amazon. You can see a perfume bottle and various photographs of that bottle, various angles of that bottle which have been captured and uploaded onto Amazon. So when you are wanting to upload onto Amazon, this is very, very crucial. You need to know what they want. So you should see these sample images and then click. Again on Amazon, if you look at the main page, if you're searching for something, this is the only image of each product you get. So this image also is something which you need. The background should be completely white, etc. But if you want to be a little more creative, so you have your own website or you have some e-commerce website where you have the option to go a little creative, these are the type of images you can also click. These are shown, if you go to Pinterest, you will get ideas of all this. And extremely easy to implement. They look very creative, but if you see it, it is extremely easy to implement. So step two, what is the setup and location? Now in our house, there are huge number of opportunities that you have to actually set up your product. So first and foremost point is you should have good light source. The best light source which we have on this earth is the sun. Okay, but the sun can be harsh. So we need to have a soft light which is coming through from a large window or a large light source. So something like this. So there are two setups which we are talking about here. The setup on the left, which talks about the direction of the, both of them talk about the direction of the light. The one on the left shows uniform front lighting. So the light is coming through from the window directly onto the product, right on the front face of the product. While on the right, the image, through one direction. So there will be a gradient of light. So there will be more light on one side of the photograph and lesser light on the other side of the photograph. So it depends on what is your requirement in terms of lighting. So if you need even lighting, the left one is the way to go. If you want gradient lighting, the right side setup is the way to go. Then how do you get a background? It should ideally be plain. And you have to be very careful about the color that you choose of the background. It should not be a bright color. So red, yellow, orange, these colors look attractive, but they will take away all the focus from the product and it will be on the background, which is attractive and colorful. So ideally have a plain white background. You could use a cloth or a chart or whatever things you have at home, which is shown here in this photograph. Now, it should be a continuous flowing background. In the left image, where we are showing continuous flow and no seam, the chart paper is flowing from top right till the bottom where the product is there. The product is sitting on the same background. So here in such a photo, you will not get a seam, which we had seen in the first slide. I will take you through that in the demo as well. On the right side image, there is a chart paper which has been put up on a chair. Now, on the left side, this requires a little bit of a professional setup. But the right side, you can all do it at home. This is a chair with a chart paper which has been clipped on with clips. All these clips are lying around at home. So, we can just clip on these charts to our chair and be ready to go with a product shoot. Obviously, you will need a product to be small. If there is a larger product, you will need to go for a little more professional setup. Props. Okay. Now, these are very, very interesting. They look good, but in product photography, these props should always be minimal. You want your focus to be on the product and not the props. I'll show you an example. Although this photograph is looking very good, but there is too much of distraction around. There are too many flowers and leaves and buds around. So if you have only these two flowers which I have marked and remove everything else, maybe the photograph will look much better because the focus will come back onto the perfume bottle. So we should not overdo our props, is what I'm trying to say. Okay, this is, I think, the most critical and crucial part of photography, which is lighting. It makes or breaks your photograph. Very, very important. We should always avoid harsh lights. When the timing of your shoot is extremely crucial. So suppose you are creating a setup close to your window. You have to be sure what time of the day is the sun the brightest in that on that window, or sunlight is coming through from the window into your house at what time. So suppose your window is facing the west, the sun will be harsh in the evenings. And if your window is facing the east, the sun will be harsh when in the mornings during about 10 or 11 o'clock. So that is the time when the sun is harsh. You should avoid shooting there. You would always require soft light. I'll show you an example. When there is harsh light, you can see the left side image where there are a lot of areas where light is reflecting, it is burnt out. It's not a very, very, a very, very plain image, and even lighting is not available. But when there is soft light, those reflections are hardly there and the image is more soothing to the eye. So you should always see that you do not have harsh light. You should always look for soft light. Okay. Additional light sources or modifiers. I will explain this point through this image. Now, if you look at the image which is titled No Fill, there is a light which is coming through only from one side. But because of that, on the left where the arrow is pointing out, the shadows are there where you are unable to see the details of the product. So in such a case, you will face this a lot of times. In such a case, what is to be done? In such a case, you will need to add up light from the left, because on the right side, the details are clearly visible, but on the left side, they are not. So you need to add up some light from the left. How do you do that? It's either through additional sources of light. At home, what are the additional sources of light? We can have a torch. We can have another phone, which will through its flashlight. But these, when we are having another source of light, these will be very harsh sources of light. So harsh light will be falling onto your subject. So we do not want that. So what we use are modifiers, which are reflectors. Okay, so reflectors are very, very easy to make. I will also go through that a little later. We can just have a white sheet of paper or a foil or anything, which I'll show you, and fill up this area with reflections rather than a new light. I'll take you through that in the demo as well. Okay, then another important aspect of photography is framing. Like we spoke about, focus forms part of framing. In this photograph, if you can see, a squirrel is running in the foreground, but the focus is on the grass which is in the background. So this photo is not usable. This will happen even with your product photography if you're not very careful. In your phones nowadays, you can tap onto the product where you want the focus to be there. So always ensure and recheck before you click any photograph that your focus is perfect and wherever you exactly want it to be. That's point one. Zoom. Now this is very, very easy to mistake upon. So if you're zooming in too much, there will be parts of the photograph which will cut off. for example, in this photograph, the front of the shoe has been cut off because we are trying to zoom in too much. But on the flip side, if you are very, very wide, then the photograph forms a very, very small part of your image. You should always look at covering at least 60 to 70% of your frame with the photograph, with the subject. Okay. Now, avoid clutter. This is a very, very crucial point. If you can see these three arrows, it shows distractions and clutter which is around the product which you are clicking. The attraction or the distraction for the viewer will be these things first. So try to avoid as much clutter as there. It's ideal for a product photography that only the product should be there. There should be nothing else in the frame. Okay, now framing. Framing for product photography is crucial because you need to be at eye level. Now, I have shown you an example here. Low eye level and high. So suppose you're below the product. Your camera is below the product. The photograph will come out like what has been titled as low. If you're at eye level, then this is how the photograph will come out. And if you click from a position which is high, like we have seen the photograph on the left, he's standing and clicking something which is down. This is a kind of photograph you'll get. So it depends upon what kind of output you need. Ideally for product photography, you should be at eye level. You have to capture angles which are on the left, right, top view, etc. For that, you can change around, but the photograph should ideally be at eye level. Also, you have to capture various details. So suppose there is a watch, for example, and there is a very interesting hour hand in that. So you would want to highlight that through your photography by going in close and clicking only that hour hand and showing it in one of your photographs. So you need to understand your product to and what you want to showcase to the viewer and capture those details. Okay, this again is an important aspect. Once your photography is done, a little bit of post-processing would be required when you're cropping off some aspects which are a little distracting, or your framing was not correct when you click the photograph, but through cropping you can frame it better. I'll show you some samples on that also. We can use that. But there are free softwares like Snapseed, Google Photos, Lightroom. These are all free softwares which you can use to do some basic editing. What all can you play around with? So first thing which you should play around is with is contrast. Now, if you can see these three images, if the photograph has a low contrast, you can see the shadow of that rock which is pointed out with a green arrow. It is merging actually with the water. So do you want a photograph to look like that, or a high contrast image where the shadow is completely distinct from the water? So we will have to take a call depending upon the product which we are shooting. What kind of contrast do we need? So that's one thing you can play around with. Then we move on to brightness. Brightness is very important. It's very easy to overexpose your image when you're playing around with brightness in post-processing. So you have to be very careful that the photograph can be as bright so that it doesn't kill all the details which are there in the picture. So that's the brightness part. Saturation. Saturation, as the name suggests, is the amount of color which is there in your photograph. For example, on this photo, if you desaturate the image, means you remove all the saturation which is there, the photo will become black and white. But if you saturate it to an extent where it becomes oversaturated, it starts looking very unreal, like the photograph on the right side, which is titled oversaturated. Here the leaves are not looking real. The green color in the leaves is not looking real. The pink is extremely dark pink in the flowers. So although you can play with saturation, but be careful that you're not overdoing it and killing the image. Little advanced can be shadows and highlights, which you can play with. But these are things which as beginners we should avoid doing, because they can actually spoil the image, which could be good, and playing around with shadows and highlights will maybe spoil it also. So it's best to avoid doing that unless trained. Filters in product photography especially, please avoid them. Let them be for your Instagram feeds, but products should be as they are. There should not be any filters associated with it. Otherwise, it's giving a very wrong picture when you're showing that product. So avoid filters for product photography. Okay, so we'll go through some settings which we can do in pro mode on our phone. So you would all have a pro mode in your phones, whatever may be your phone. The way to get there is there'll be a lot of options which you have. This is from a OnePlus phone. So you just need to, if you can see this arrow over here, you just need to click that and you'll get all these options coming through. So you choose pro mode. Once you choose pro mode, you will have a lot of settings to play around with. I'll take you through three important settings here. The first one is ISO. Now this is the sensitivity that your camera has. So a low ISO setting, I'll show you this. Low ISO setting, ISO ranges from this, in this camera, it ranges from 100 to about 3200. You can also have an auto ISO mode, which is mentioned here. So low ISO will give you low grains. So the lower the ISO, I had shown you a grainy image in the first slide. If your ISO is extremely low, those grains will be extremely low. But the flip side is, if your ISO is low, the photograph will be dark. So if you increase your ISO, it will become brighter. So for example, the same settings, if the ISO changes from ISO 100 to 800, this is what the difference in the image becomes. This is from a phone only, I am showing you. Okay, so you have to strike a balance. On your phone, ideally 100 to 300 ISO, you should not exceed that, because then you'll start seeing grains in your photographs. 300 to 400 ISO should be good enough for you to click. When you go to 800, you will be able to see grains if a little bit of zoom is done also. So avoid going up to 800 also. Shutter speed. This is also critical to control the light falling onto your sensor. So if you look at the settings pages, how shutter speed is defined is, if you can see this, 1 divided by 15. This means 1 divided by 15 of a second, your sensor will be exposed to light. Means the light will fall onto your sensor for 1 divided by 15 seconds. So the more the light which falls onto the sensor, the darker will be your image. But and on the right side, you can see the same setting is 1 divided by 125. So you can see the image is dark. It is a little darker. So you can play around with these settings in your phone to see what exactly suits you, the product or the setup at that point of time. Exposure. Now this is also a critical aspect to play around with. If you can see, the exposure is here, the plus minus sign. Okay, in most phones it would be about you will be able to go up to 3. In this particular OnePlus phone, you could go up to 2. Okay, so if you increase the exposure, the lights, the brightness, the contrast, etc. will increase. If you reduce the exposure levels, this will, the lights, etc. will fall. So you can see both these images, if it is plus 2, you are seeing a very bright image. If it is minus 2, you are seeing a very dark image. So you will have to adjust this exposure. Ideally, this should be at 0. It should neither be overexposed, neither it should be underexposed. Okay, so now I will go on to a demo where I have set up the background, the base, the lightings, framing, and maybe the phone settings also we will go through. So if I can just take maybe a minute to set this up, and I will come back. We are keeping a chair right next to the window so that we get some light onto the chair. I'll show you the chair. This is the chair which we are using. Okay, now the chair has a soft base. Okay, so what we are trying to use as a base which will keep it stable is a slate. We can keep this slate here, And the background would be a white cloth, so that we get a white background and the cloth flows down right till the bottom, so that we get a seamless background. So this seam will not be visible because it's a continuous flowing background. So this is what our setup will be. Now, as I was saying, these are distractions. This is a distraction for us, this clip. This clip is a distraction for us. So there are maybe this seam, if you can see, this is a point where we have stuck it to the chair. This can be a distraction for us depending on the image which we get. So you will need to maybe in post processing look at how to avoid having that in our frame. So these are issues you will have to address through post processing. So what we try to capture here is the perfume bottle which we had spoken about during our first slide, or the sample images as well. So I'll just try to focus a little bit on the product. Can you see a lot of a little bit of shadows which are coming through over here? One second.
Yes, we can.
So these there is shadows which are being which are coming through over here because of the light which is coming unidirectionally. Okay, so this is not a light which is directly onto the face of the product, that is coming through from one side only. So there will be shadows which we can see here. Now, how do you fill in these shadows? First, I'll fill it, and then I will show you how did I do it. Okay. So, can you see the light changing? This is done through a product which is created by at home only. This is a plate and a foil has been wrapped around. Okay, what does this foil do? The foil reflects the light which is falling onto this, onto your product. Now you can see the shadows which are being which were cast by the outside light are more or less taken care of. Also, if you will see the cap of this particular perfume bottle, the light will change onto the cap, right? So you will see some light falling onto the cap. It will start looking better or worse. So you will have to take a call whether you actually want this light or not. Whether you want these shadows or not is also a call which you will need to take, right? So this is one homemade item which you can use as a modifier for any kind of photography. Even when you're taking photos of your child or something, there are shadows which come through, and if you want to avoid those shadows, you can always use reflectors. If you want to invest a little money also into this, I will show you something more. I don't know whether you guys can see this or not. So these are 5-in-1 modifiers which come through. Quite big for our screen. Can you see the entire thing? Okay.
I can see it on the laptop screen, Varun, so it's okay.
Okay, so this black part is what is called as this will not reflect the light, but it will take off the light. So if you now see this, the lighting on the okay, can you guys see my screen? I think something has gone wrong. Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir. Okay. I can see. If any attendee, if anybody is having a problem, please go ahead and ask me.
Okay, fine, no problem. So this is a black part which we are blocking the light from. So now the shadows which were coming through on the left are now coming on the right because we have a large tube light on top. So I'll show you the tube light as well. There is a tube light here which is throwing light onto the product. and we are blocking off the light from the from our main source through this black thing. Now, if you look at the opposite side, we have a big reflector here. Okay, a similar one which was created by us with using the plate. So, if I keep the reflector here, then you see how light changes onto our product. Oh, you can see the change in the light. So here, your when we are adding this reflector, the light or the shadows disappear. So there are four or five things which you can do with this. There is a diffuser also. So suppose you have harsh light coming through. You can have a diffuser. So I'll show you one more thing which is homemade, which you can use as diffuser. So this is a tracing paper. Okay, you can use tracing paper as a diffuser. So if you have harsh light coming through, so let me just get my phone. I will show you how to diffuse this harsh light. Just a second. Okay, now I have switched on the flashlight of my phone. Can you see the harsh shadows which are coming through? Right, so now if you want to get rid of these shadows, I will just add a tracing paper in front of this. One second. When we add a tracing paper, then a lot of the shadows will disappear. So I'll just show you before and after. This is before. When I'm adding a tracing paper, the light still comes through, but at a diffused state. Can you see the difference? So a lot of shadows which come through can be taken care of by this. So you are having a shadow on the right. Now when you're adding a diffuser as well as a new light, it takes care of the shadow. So this is what a few things which you can make at home. Now let's go on to clicking with our phone. How do we get an image to our phone? So we have taken care of the background, we have taken care of the lights. I have shown you what the lights can do. Now we'll go on to our phone. I'll go to Pro mode first. Okay, and as I had spoken about in framing, we will do our framing at eye level. So see how the image is coming through. Can you see my phone?
Varun, you'll have to move the camera a little lower. Yes, this is better.
Okay, so which we need to do is focus. So click on this bottle. Just need to click on this bottle and your camera will focus onto the bottle. Okay. As I had said, around 50% or 60% of the frame should have your product. So zoom in as much as possible and get this. Now in a lot of new phones, there are two or three lenses which we have. There are zoom lenses which can be used to actually zoom in. So if you have an option to zoom in and have a portrait mode, you can use that particular mode. It will have a much better effect. Now, one more thing which you should try to do is keep this particular product as far away from the background as possible. Okay, so as far away from the background so that there is a lot of space. There is a lot of space between the background and the product, but it doesn't look like it's extremely close by. So now in this image, if you can see my phone, there is a lot of shadows which are coming through over here. Right, so we will first try to get rid of those shadows using our plate
and which is actually a reflector. So what we are doing here is we are getting rid of shadows. Can you see? Okay. And when we are getting rid of shadows, what is happening here is that there is a lot of light also which is starting to come onto the from the left side onto the bottle. So you can see a little more details. So here I have clicked the photograph. We will go a little further back and click one more. Now if you see this photograph on my phone, I'll just show you. There is this area which we will have to crop off in post-processing, because this is going to be a distraction. There is this area which again we will need to crop off in post-processing. That is again a distraction which is there, right? So in post-processing you will need to do these things. If you feel that this is a little dark, you need to add something more to it. See over here, we are not getting the text which is written here, okay? So maybe we will have to click another photograph where light falls onto this particular text. Okay, so this, now if you look at this, without the reflector, there the text is not visible because the light is not falling onto that text at all, right? But now if I'm adding a reflector, you can immediately see the entire text. You look at my phone screen, it will be more visible on my phone screen. So here I do not have a reflector. Here I am just adding a reflector from below. This shows us the text also. So once we have the text, we again give a click and check our photograph. How is it looking now? We have our text. We have this. Although there is a little bit of shadows around here, we can add another reflector here, maybe another plate with the foil attached. You may need an assistant who could be your wife or your family member. So you can just have somebody to assist you. So I normally do the assistance for a lot of my friends. And so it's best if you learn a lot about lighting when you're actually assisting somebody. So it's good to assist. So this is the photograph which we've taken. This is a small demo which I wanted to make. We covered the background, we covered lighting, diffusers, and all we can.
Sorry to interrupt. There is another question which is very interesting. So I'm going to leave it if you can do that right now. Somebody asked, how do we capture a detail like, you know, the cap of the bottle? So could you, if you don't mind, would it be possible for you to show that? Yeah.
So for this, again, I think that's a good question, and we have a good subject also for answering that. If you see the cap of this bottle, it has a lot of details, right? Can you see the bottle with the details on the bottle?
Yes.
So, it will be more prudent that we use a camera for that. So if I can show you through my camera, you're just zooming in here and focusing. So sometimes you will need to use a lens which can focus close by. So a macro lens will suit such requirements. So this is how, okay, so the framing is extremely poor because I'm holding both the camera as well as things. So we will need to work on that. That's how you capture details through your camera. What I'll try to do now is capture through the phone. The phones nowadays have macro modes. So let me check if mine has it. This has portrait. Okay, so this is the focus. Can you see my phone screen or is it not visible? Once again, I'll just... Okay, now can you see my phone screen? Okay, so this is something which is called as a focus pointer. Here you have macro mode, and here you have landscape mode. Okay, so when you're using macro mode, the phone can go a little closer to your subject and capture details. So I don't know whether you all are able to see me or not. So when you're using macro mode, you need to be really close to the subject. So if you can see how close I am to the bottle and you click the photograph, again, be very careful in such circumstances that there should not be any reflection which is coming through from yourself or the camera from which you're taking the photo. Okay, I will need to click this again. The closer you go, the better it gets. Okay, now I'll show you this photo on my phone. I don't know whether you'll be able to see it or not. Are you able to figure out? I don't think so. Okay, so this is a sharp image because it is a macro, because we chose the macro mode. So in a macro mode, the closer you go to your subject, the more easily will your lens focus. So we need to do that in the macro mode of our phone. Every phone will have that. So you need to just explore the settings there. So any other question, or we can go back to the presentation? Demo, this was what I wanted to cover. Okay.
Varun, I think we can go back to the presentation. It was a extremely good demo. We have a few questions about post edit. So if you could, once you're back on your laptop, you would want to talk about...
So I'll just stop sharing my screen. So I'll start sharing that presentation again. Okay, can you see the screen now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this is all, we covered all this, the base, the background, the lightings. Okay, this is one point which I wanted to add. You could see how much of effort we had to make to do this setup, etc. Now there are light boxes which are available online, very cheap, 400, 500, 700 bucks. What this light box does is, it is a small square, okay, which is covered with diffusers on three sides. Okay, so what we are trying to do as diffusers or adding some light, some reflectors, etc. Already they have done it on three sides. So the background, both the left and the right side, the top and the bottom, all are covered with white translucent cloth. Okay. If you want more light from one place, you can add additional lights on each web from wherever you want, so that particular side is lit up. So light box is extremely crucial. If I will share the links for the light box with Ashish so that he can share it with all of you all. So investing in a light box will not be a bad idea. Well, all you need to do is keep that light box, click, and it's done. Okay, so the background is taken care of, the sides are taken care of, etc. I will share links. We spoke about framing, the eye, at eye level we had to take photographs, etc. And we also saw phone settings which we could work on. Right. Now, last point, although we have gone through what all we can do on our own, I think e-commerce, there is a lot that you can do on your own as individual business owners. You can click photographs and you can actually look like a professional photographer. But still, there will be occasions where you will need a professional. Okay, so that things are looking much better. So the first instance which I feel a professional is required is when you need better image quality. The lighting, backgrounds, etc. They need to be a little more technical. That is when I think a professional will be very, very helpful to you. there is some artistic perspective he can bring about. So that is again a place where professionals will help. If there is a model which is required, so if there are apparel shoots, etc. So if you need a model, a professional photographer is extremely helpful because he will help with the model as well as the location for the shoot, etc. Now, like somebody asked a question on the cap, the details on the cap, or if there is a watch which you have, where you want the intricate details of that watch to be captured, you will need equipment which can actually go and capture those details, which we call as macro photography. If we want, we can cover that sometime later. So that macro photographs will require that kind of equipment to be available. So it is crucial that we have a professional if you want, if that is extremely crucial for you. And when images are to be printed, it is extremely crucial that the quality is good. Now, if we are clicking with our phones and trying to print big images, there is a possibility that it will pixelate or those grains will be visible because the sensors of the cameras of the phones are a little smaller than what professional cameras have. So if you have to print, then definitely go in for a professional, or if you have a camera on your own, you should click with the camera and not with your phone. So I think this is all I wanted to share with you guys aspects. But if there is any question specific to something which I've not covered or what I've covered, maybe you could just throw that at me now.
Sorry, Varun, I was on mute. Thank you so much, first of all. I was entranced. I was just looking at the whole thing. As you know, I'm not a great camera person myself. So I'll throw the first few questions at you. So we have Shrini from Australia who's asking us, do you have a preferred camera app?
So camera app, normally, see, today, nowadays, most of the camera, the phone companies are coming with good camera apps. Okay, so I would prefer using the standard camera app which is there in your phone, because all these camera apps. So suppose Pixel uses our Pixel phones, which are known for very, very good software. They use camera apps, but they are actually designed for the hardware of Pixel. So I have seen a lot of times it malfunctioning in other phones. So I would always suggest go in for the app which you already have built into your phone. Play around with those pro settings which are there. That will make a very big difference in your photography than changing the app. So the hardware remains the same. It's just the software which is playing around. So what I would suggest is play around with settings, those ISO settings. Maybe the backgrounds, etc., whatever you have. Focus also makes a big difference. Which lens? So there are 2-3 lenses nowadays in cameras. Which lens you are using? It really changes the image. All these factors change the image. So the app, to come to that question again, I would suggest go for the same camera which you have in your phone.
Thank you for that. Another question which is very specific is that Harish has metallic shiny products and he's seeing a reflection in his image. So I think you have covered some of it, but could you sort of help him with that as well?
Yes. So it's the biggest problem that you have in metallic products. So first thing which you have to do, which I covered in my presentation, is clean. So you have to first clean your product. That will show up even more reflections. So I'm not addressing your question, but the first point is you have to clean it so that there is no dust visible. On any shiny product, there will be a lot of dust visible. So first step is cleaning that. Second step is using diffusers. Okay, like I showed in the tracing paper, when you're having light which is falling onto a shiny surface, it's going to reflect that shiny that light source. Suppose it's a tube light, you'll be able to see that tube light on that in your photograph. When you are adding a diffuser, maybe a one tracing paper, not two tracing papers put together, you add one tracing paper, it will soften the light. Once the light is softened, you will be able to see that the reflections are not there, because the light is not falling at one point, it is falling across the surface. So you will have to use diffusers if you don't want reflections. The best way to avoid to do that is have your light box, which I had spoken about. So it covers all the sides and it just gives you one window to shoot from. It will help you avoid the shiny reflections.
Great, thank you so much. We have a question about a tripod. So in case we don't have a home tripod, is there something we can use to stabilize the camera?
I think it's breathing techniques. So I have always used breathing techniques to stabilize my hand to shoot. I have hardly used tripods unless I want to do some astrophotography or all those complicated things. I have hardly used tripods. It's about how stable you can keep your hand. And an extremely easy way to do it is hold your breath for 2 seconds before you click your photograph. You will see how that stability of your hand changes. It is a very, very, it's a tip which I had got when I started photography, but I still use it. So you hold your breath for 2 seconds, click, and you will see that it is not shaking. So for product photography also, you will have lights coming in from everywhere. It's not that you need something to be stable, your hands to be extremely stable for that. So shutter speed, if I can talk a little more technical, if your shutter speed is about 1/100 or little more than that, then you do not require any kind of tripod to keep yourself stable. So I would suggest, as beginners, do not invest right now in tripods. Try to use your handheld photographs only. Take help from people to hold your products, your setups, etc., so that you are free to just hold your camera and click. So I would suggest currently don't go in for a tripod.
Thank you, Varun. I know the time is up. We are already over by a minute. But there are a lot of questions around editing. So if you don't mind just talking to us about how to, what are the apps or what are the things that we can use to edit our photos a little bit?
So I think Lightroom is an excellent app which we can use on our phone itself. So there are a lot of features, basic features in Lightroom, which you can use for free. You do not need to pay anything to use those features. It's a free app. Snapseed is another very, very intelligent app which will see your photograph and automatically tell you, okay, this is what you should be doing to your photograph to make it look better. So Snapseed, Lightroom, and if you're using Google Android phones, your Google Photos is also an app which helps you do basic editing. So I think basic editing, you should, for product photography, cropping is extremely essential. That frame should be perfect. Maybe moving here, there could be a photograph which is a little tilted. So you'll need to rotate the photo and all that. So all these small basic things, I think Google Photos helps beautifully. Snapseed is intelligent. And Lightroom will let you do whatever you want to do if you want to get into a little more detail on that. So Lightroom is good. Snapseed and Google Photos for me.
Perfect. Thank you. Questions are still flowing in, so I'm just taking as many as I possibly can. Quick one. Is it okay to click photos with the flash mode on the photo during low light settings?
Okay, very good question. Why do we use flash? Is the basic fundamental which we should first address. We use flash to lighten up the subject which we are clicking, or if it is extremely dark, you want some light to be there so that your photo comes through. That is the point of time we use flash. That is the purpose of flash. But what we are trying to do in product photography is we are ensuring light is there. So we are going close to a window, we are adding diffusers, we are adding more lights, etc., so that the lighting is as we want it to be. And then we are clicking. So if we are doing all this lighting arrangements and then adding a flash, it will spoil all these arrangements which we have done. So the flash will give a light which will go right from your phone to onto the subject. There will be background, there will be shadows which will be posted onto the background, which you cannot see right now, because when the flash comes through, that's when your shadows will come through. So flash has to be used when you're not setting up lights. When you're setting up lights, when you're doing all the setup of the lighting, etc., avoid using flash, because that will again spoil all the lighting which lighting setup which you have done.
Thank you. Okay, one final one, Varun. If somebody has products made out of which are white in color, right? So we have Vignesh here who says he makes products made out of recycled paper, which is white or natural shade. So what is the kind of background they should use to capture that?
So see, when your product is white, you can go in for a black background. Okay, don't go in for a white background, because then there are a lot of chances that white against white, you will miss out on a lot of key details. Okay, when you look at photographs white on white, they are very professionally managed. These lightings need to be very, very critically managed. So when you're clicking a white object which is on a bright which is on a white background, you need to ensure that the background and the product are distinguished from each other. So the light falling onto the subject has to be very different, and the light falling onto the background has to be very different. So it has to be very controlled when it's white on white. But if you're using a black background, it is completely separating the product and the background. So it's always better that if there is a product which is white, you choose a black background. You will have the background blacked out, and you will be able to see all details on your white product. If you want white on white, the lighting has to be a little more intricately managed.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Varun. We have a few more questions. Of course, we can't take it on the webinar anymore, but what we will do is try and answer them separately. If we don't, please feel free to send us an email. You see the email addresses on the screen here, and we will be sending you a copy of this. Hopefully, if you have any further feedback, Varun has agreed to do a follow-up webinar after this. So if you have questions, if you have specific things that you want us to cover, we will take up a second webinar as well, which will carry on from here. Again, thank you everyone for attending this. I hope you enjoyed this, and I really want to thank Varun again to take time off on his weekend on a Saturday, and time away from his family, his wife, his kid. And thank you again so much. And guys, any further questions, please write to us. And thank you so much for attending today.
It's been my pleasure. Thanks, Ashish.
Thank you, Varun. All right. Thank you so much. We'll see you soon. Bye-bye.
Thanks everyone for attending. Thank you.